night, good night, good night to my beautiful San Fernando, west, east, and everywhere around us. I say good night to the first citizen of San Fernando, His Worship the Mayor, to the second citizen of San Fernando, the Deputy Mayor, to my distinguished political leader and honorable Prime Minister of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, Dr. Keith Christopher Rowley, to my cabinet colleagues, my cabinet colleague Rohan Sinanan, the Minister of Works, to my parliamentary colleague, Member for San Fernando East and Minister in the Ministry of Finance, Brian Manning, to the beautiful and talented Senator Laurel Lizama Leasing at the head table, to my cabinet colleagues sitting in the audience, the distinguished Kazim Hussein, the distinguished member, Mr. McClashy himself, coming from further south, to Lady Joan Yule Williams, councillors, members all, San Fernando West Executive, I have come tonight to read and spell. And tonight, in reading and spelling, or spelling and reading, and in connecting dots, whichever way you go, backward or forward, I want to say thank you, first of all, to my colleague, and thank you to my Prime Minister for making sure that San Fernando's development has been center point in Trinidad and Tobago. You heard Rohan speak tonight about our development works. You see it all around you. You see our magistrates' court under development. You see our housing projects under development. You see our waterfront under development. You see the hospital car park under development. You see Skinner Park being reformed and refashioned. You see business and enterprise all around you. But where do we stand, ladies and gentlemen, in Trinidad and Tobago? Monday night, we are inflicted by a forum. Every morning, we are inflicted by someone who goes under the label Dogla Politics. Midweek, another presentation. Sunday morning, press conference. Political agitation is important. There is democracy in this country. But let us look at where we stand as we try to develop ourselves. And let me ask you, as we sew together the fabric of where we are, I want to make this supposition that Trinidad and Tobago is under constitutional attack. And in standing under constitutional attack, there is nothing sacred in the mouth of the leader of the opposition, Mrs. Prasad Bisesa. I wish to say why. Because it is not for a politician, certainly an office holder of the office that I hold, thanks to the Honorable Prime Minister, to make statements idly. It is important to ground statements by logic and reason and without insult where possible. So where do we stand in the supreme law of Trinidad and Tobago, the Constitution? We know that under the Constitution, there is a Prime Minister's office. We know that the executive is headed by Section 74 of the Constitution by the President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. We know under Section 76(2) of the Constitution that there is an office holder referred to as the Attorney General who has the constitutional remit for managing legal affairs in Trinidad and Tobago. We know that the Constitution says that in managing legal affairs, that civil proceedings are to be brought in the name of the Attorney General and criminal proceedings are to be brought in the name of the state. We know that Section 80 of the Constitution says how the President goes about consultation. We know that Section 81 of the Constitution requires the office holder of the Prime Minister to address Her Excellency, in this case the President, on all matters of importance. These are not Faris Al-Rawi's words. These are the words of the Constitution of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. We know that Section 90 of the Constitution says that you have an office of the Director of Public Prosecutions. And Section 90 says that the DPP has three powers. The power to begin prosecutions or institute them. The power to take over prosecutions or criminal proceedings that may have begun by someone else. The third power is the power to end criminal prosecutions that may have begun by someone else. That's the words of the Constitution read out in the context I've put. We know that the Constitution sets out in Section 36 that there can be a removal of a president. But today, in the leader of the opposition, we have someone that seeks to tell a story that defies the language, the reason, the logic, and the jurisprudence of the Constitution. And permit me to say why. In our constitutional arrangement, there is an attack that the Prime Minister is under. There are fabrications that say that the Prime Minister should have no consultation with the office holder of the President. There is a running commentary that the Prime Minister should effectively have a video recorder on at all points in time and live stream his conversations with the office of the President on matters of constitutional importance. There is a submission coming from Mrs. Prasad Bisesa that the office of the Attorney General is taking over in an unholy way the role of the DPP in criminal prosecutions. There is a statement from the leader of the opposition that Her Excellency the President must be removed from office. And Trinidad and Tobago stands on the edge of constitutional issues that are first in our history. As on Thursday we go to the Electoral College, that's the House of Representatives and the Senate, to go and have a discussion that Mrs. Prasad Bisesa says is so serious that the President ought to be removed. Anybody looking on outside of Trinidad and Tobago will be fed the constant diatribe that something is wrong in this country. Which country in the Commonwealth, do you know, has taken steps to say that a president has done something of such a serious manner of disorder, of failure of office, that the president ought to be removed? Where in your conscious reflection are you even aware of that in the CARICOM or in the Commonwealth that we are a part of? Now let's start to put these things together. You may notice that for many, many days on end, that the leader of the opposition has had a lot to say about me. A lot. How I look, how I dress, how I talk, who is my family, where I'm coming from, what kind of lawyer I am. But folks, let's be real, we in San Fernando West, in my home, this has been going on since 2010. It's nearly 12 years later. So the day that Mrs. Prasad Bisesa has nothing to say about me, that's the day I'll worry. But in looking at the allegations that the leader of the opposition has said, something struck me today when my beautiful, intelligent, powerful colleague, Renuka Sagram Singh Suklal, was speaking today. She read out, she made mention of a press release coming from the Law Association today. And the Law Association put out a press release today, 19th October 2021, cautioning a newspaper on commentary made by the Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago. And the Prime Minister was referring to a case called Akili Charles, where Mr. Anand Ramlogan has gone to court, is seeking to set aside the law which says that you cannot access bail if you're on a charge for murder, as he's entitled to do. But the Law Association says it calls upon office holders and by extension the public to refrain from making public statements that may infringe the sub judice rule. You know what the sub judice rule is? If it's in court, don't talk about it. And I want to ask you here today, in the constitutional arrangements that I have just set up, when you see Mrs. Prasad Bisesa for a month plus talking about the Ravi Balgobin Maharaj case and weaving conspiracy theories day and night about the Prime Minister and about the Attorney General and about the President, when the judge had not yet ruled, I ask, where was the voice of the Law Association? I ask you tonight, when you hear Mrs. Prasad Bisesa day and night, when you hear Anil Roberts day and night, when you hear Jayanti Lakshmidiyal day and night talking about a fella named Vincent Nelson Queen's counsel and going in to commentary in relation to whether there is an indemnity or coverage by the state and what the Attorney General did and what the Attorney General may or may not have done to secure a whistleblower to give evidence in the courts where a fair trial is expected, where guilt or innocence can happen, where Mr. Anand Ramlogan and Mr. Gerald Ramdean are involved. Where is the voice of the Law Association on that? Her Excellency the President, in a press release on the weekend, said why she just came out and spoke to certain facts, stating in black and white that she was obliged to await the outcome of the court decision. Well, folks, I am the supposed titular head of the bar, and tonight I am saying to the Law Association, I think that your commentary lacks balance on this occasion. I say that most respectfully. And I say in relation to these matters that I want you to observe the field of play. I'm not going to go into the sub judice principle. I'm not going to speak about evidence in court matters. But I would like to tell you that in discharge of the functions that I have entrusted to me by the Honorable Prime Minister, in discharging the management of legal affairs in Trinidad and Tobago, I'd like to tell you, number one, the Office of the Attorney General is the lawyer for the President's office. Number two, in making representations to the court, when the presidency raises the issue of acting appointments and asks the court to consider whether all acting appointments should go to the parliament, that Her Excellency the President, with the voice of the Attorney General, has secured a clarification of the Constitution which says all acting appointments need to go to the parliament. Not just Mr. Griffith, not Mr. Jacobs, Mr. Filbert, Mr. Gibbs when he left and people had to act, Mr. Stephen Williams. Every acting appointment from the year 2009 to date, which numbers close to 200 acting appointments, have all had to go to the parliament. Is this any constitutional tragedy for Trinidad and Tobago? No. The laws of Trinidad and Tobago are constantly under review. And when the Honorable Prime Minister was speaking to the Akili Charles case, we know that since 1994, we've had a Bail Act. And that Bail Act crystallized the common law, put it into a statute and said, if you're on a charge for murder, you will not be allowed bail. That is under consideration. We await the court's decision. We know that on the 2nd of November 2021, the Privy Council will sit with 11 judges of the Privy Council, and they will consider whether we can still use the death penalty to hang people. That was under review in the case of Matthews, where they upheld the death penalty as a mandatory penalty, reversing an earlier decision where they said there's no mandatory death penalty. So the law is always there for clarification. But we listen to the leader of the opposition tell us that there's scandal, there's success. She knew all along that all acting appointments had to go to Parliament. Then I asked Mrs. Prasad Bisesa, number one, is it not true to say you are betraying your oath as an officer of the court because you know that the law is constantly under review? Number two, if your silk as senior counsel is to be taken seriously, isn't it true to say that you as prime minister acted for 5 years and 3 months watching the law applied in the opposite direction that you now see? Because you allowed Stephen Williams to act, you allowed Filbert to act, you allowed persons who acted whilst Gibbs was out to act. Let's deal with Mrs. Prasad Bisesa a little bit more. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa says to the country that it is a landmark scandal for a judge to correct an order when the rules of the Supreme Court provide for something called the slip rule. Every lawyer fresh out of law school knows that a judge is entitled to correct an order to make it in line with what they have said in court or reasoned in the decision. That happened in a recent matter. That was met with the leader of the opposition saying the judge is biased, that the judge is related to Christine Kangaloo, that the judge should never have acted when you distill the comments that she has said, and that the attorney general, according to the leader of the opposition, so frightened the judge by a press release that the judge was compelled to change the order in the dead of night. Ladies and gentlemen, every judge is aware, as every lawyer ought to be, that there is a right of appeal on judgments. Every judge must expect, if you're a magistrate, that you will be appealed, if you're a high court judge, that you will appeal, that you'll be appealed, and if you're a court of appeal judge, except in an election petition, that you will be appealed. But we are listening to Mrs. Prasad Bisesa take this story down that line. Where is Mrs. Prasad Bisesa? Mrs. Prasad Bisesa, if you start to connect dots, and if you start to look at the structures, the constant reference to office holders, the prime minister, the president, and certainly me, Mrs. Prasad Bisesa, I wish to point out today, is somebody intent on tripping the fair trial provisions. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa has been unrestrained, certainly not by the Law Association, from talking about the Vincent Nelson Queen's Counsel matter. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa is aware that the Office of the Attorney General functioned in such a way that Mr. Ram Logan and Mr. Ramdeen stand before the court with questions to answer. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa is aware that I stand as a witness in the witness tampering case that Mr. Ram Logan left office for in 2015. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa is aware that Mr. Roger K. Walsing is the attorney at law for Vincent Nelson Queen's Counsel. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa is aware that I am the Attorney General acting as the central authority in international investigations, some of which are in the public domain, so I'll mention only by name, the purchase of the Damon vessels, the National Crime Agency engaged in cross-border investigations. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa is aware that I am the Attorney General acting in the courts of Florida as we speak, for a trial in February 2022 to deal with the end of the Piako Airport inquiry on the civil side, where the judgment is expected to be to the tune of a quarter billion Trinidad and Tobago dollars. Now let me ask you this. You don't think it a little passing coincidental that Mrs. Prasad Bisesa has so much to say about the exercise of my functions? Do you think it appropriate that the Law Association has left all of that out from their press release today? Do you think it appropriate, folks, for me to take advice from Mrs. Prasad Bisesa on the law? Let me tell you something. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa has raised the matter of recusals. Faris Car, Faris Property, Faris Road, Faris Building. Let me tell you why I take no advice from Mrs. Prasad Bisesa. Ladies and gentlemen, I have recused, as many of my colleagues have, from a number of matters before the cabinet. And the reason has been because the Integrity in Public Life Act says that you are obliged to step aside from a matter that you may have had an interest in. And let me say publicly, wherever a matter came up where I was a lawyer acting for someone previously and the matter came up and my name was on a part of the proceedings, I recused. If I acted as a lawyer for clients who had properties coming before the cabinet, I recused. If I acted in relation to properties that came up for renewal or consideration in the cabinet, where my family is openly having been in business since 1974 with the government of Trinidad and Tobago, I am obliged to recuse. But let me tell you why, and I'll give you one example tonight, why I take no advice from Kamala Prasad Bisesa. I read from cabinet minutes of the meeting, second session of 2010, cabinet note number 1877. Present, Kamala Prasad Bisesa, Senator Anand Ramlogan, Attorney General, Tim Gopi Singh, Rupert Griffith, Errol MacLeod, Munilal, Peters, Prakash Ramada, Glenn Ramada Singh, Suraj Rambachan, Anil Roberts, Carolyn Sipasad Bachan, Chandra Sharma, Herbert Volney, Jack Warner, Therese Batiste Cornelis, Emmanuel George, Fazal Karim, Nan Ramgulam, John Sandy, Subhash Pandey. And listen to this. This is concerning the lease rental of building located at number 63A Mukurapo Road, St. James, to accommodate the Ministry of National Security. They go on to approve the rental for approximately $120,000 a month, and the note for cabinet signed by one Kamala Prasad Bisesa, that is cabinet number, the minute number is 1874, they approve the rental of this building, and listen to who owns the property. To the lease rental of this building, and the property is owned by D.W. I want to get the correct name for you. The property is owned by D.W. Property Holdings Limited. And the DW Property Holdings Limited letter, the owner of the property, signed by one Darian Warner, president. And when you read the minutes, you will see nobody recused. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa, past Attorney General. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa, Prime Minister. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa, so secure in her knowledge of the law, that she accepted her own invitation to receive silk, considered her own invitation to receive silk, and then thought it appropriate to give herself silk and give Anand Ramlogan silk on top of that, because two of them not senior counsel in December 2010. But Mrs. Prasad Bisesa tells this country that it is okay to sign preside and sit in a cabinet where the owner of the property is Jack Warner's son. Jack Warner don't recuse. Kamla don't tell him, hey, I think you need to recuse. Anand Ram Logan says nothing. Prakash Ramada, a lawyer, says nothing. Subhash Pandey, a lawyer, says nothing. Rudal Munilal, a lawyer, says nothing. And I have to take advice from Kamla Prasad Bisesa that recusal is a crime. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa, I want to say this to you most respectfully. The conflict of interest provisions in the Integrity in Public Life Act required you to ensure that Mr. Warner recused himself from this matter. And when you go through the umpteen recusals by Jack Warner, by Jerry Hadid, by Herbert Volney, by Larry Hawaii, by Kevin Ramnarine, by Nizam Baksh, by Vasant Bharat, by Marlene Kudre, by Tim Gopisingh again, and you go through in the case of Hadid and Tim Gopisingh and others, property after property after property, I want to ask you if she is someone to be taken seriously. Ladies and gentlemen, as I come to a close, what I am compelled to say to Trinidad and Tobago tonight, you need to watch the leader of the opposition, Koki Ai. I will tell you as I conclude that the investigations into the EMBD matter, that the investigations and proceedings in the life sport matter, in the diamond vessels matter, in the witness tampering matter, in the legal kickback fees matter, in the PRCO civil proceedings and other proceedings, all of them wrapped up under international cross-border investigations will be causing Mrs. Prasad Bisesa massive panic and fear. And I need the voice of the PNM to understand when you hear what you hear, you need to know the context you are hearing it in. So ladies and gentlemen, I must leave room for my distinguished Prime Minister. I thank you. There's much more to be said, but that is for another occasion. Thank you, San Fernando West. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.